Galois, Algebra, and the Rubik's Cube, the story of Evariste Galois, the beginning of modern algebra, and connections to the Rubik's Cube. Evariste Galois lived from 1811 to 1832. The first principles of group theory were discovered by Evariste Galois in the early 1800s. Group theory is the mathematical language of symmetry. Galois was one of the greatest mathematicians of his time. He solved a problem no one had been able to solve for at least 300 years before. In the process, he discovered principles of math now called group theory, a branch of modern algebra. Liberty, Leading the People is a painting by Eugene Delacroix. It commemorates an uprising in 1830 when Galois was 18 years old. Galois lived during a time of political turmoil in France immediately after the French Revolution. He was critical of the king. He was expelled from school. He joined a militia, which was disbanded out of fear it would overthrow the government, and he was sent to jail several times for activities considered threatening to the government. Tragically, Galois died at age 20 in a duel in an argument over a woman. Galois' life was filled with tragedy. His father, who fought for democratic rule rather than support the king, committed suicide a few days before Galois' college entrance exam. Galois argued with the judges at his entrance exam, certainly while in an emotionally challenged condition, stating that the judges were mathematically incorrect, and they probably were, and the judges did not accept his application. Galois' mathematical work was submitted to a prestigious competition, judged by one of the great mathematicians of the time, Joseph Fourier. Unfortunately, Fourier took Galois' work home, died unexpectedly, and the work was lost. Eventually, that work was discovered to be one of the greatest mathematical accomplishments of the century. After spending time in jail for political reasons, Galois was cared for by a woman with whom he fell in love. He was challenged to a duel by another man whose identity remains unknown. Galois wrote his mathematical ideas in a letter the night before the duel. The last thing he wrote was, "I have no time." He died the next day from a gunshot wound to the abdomen. Galois was passionate and brilliant. He defended the political rights of working people against an aristocracy. He tried in vain to communicate his brilliant mathematical ideas, ideas that eventually changed the world for the better. If he had lived, what else could Galois have done? A final tragedy is that few people know who Galois was, or what he accomplished, or what his accomplishments mean for the world. The work that Galois produced is some of the most important mathematics of the 19th century, influencing basically all of modern mathematics. His discoveries have led to advances in many sciences, including physics and chemistry, that make the modern world possible. For example, the mathematics of group theory lie at the foundation of the physics of Einstein's relativity, without which we could not have the GPS global positioning system. Group theory is the mathematics of symmetry, and it's essential to modern chemistry in studying the interactions between different molecules. Galois developed group theory in order to prove the following remarkable theorem. It is mathematically impossible to create one formula involving the operations of arithmetic and use of radicals for the solutions of polynomial equations of degree 5 or higher. Galois' proof of this theorem accomplished two things. One, it answered a centuries-old question of finding a formula to solve the quintic, that is, polynomials of degree 5. And two, it opened the door to a mathematical understanding of symmetry in general. So, before Galois' time, there were formulas to solve equations for degree 1, 2, 3, and 4. A degree 1 equation is pretty simple. In general, it looks like this, ax plus b equals 0. As an example, consider the equation 5x plus 10 equals 0. We see the solution is x equals negative 2. In this example, a would be 5 and b is 10. We could write one formula that will solve all degree 1 equations. It would look like this, x equals negative b over a. The idea of writing one formula to solve any equation goes back to at least the beginning of algebra, which was around the year 800 AD. Polynomial equations of the form ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0 are equations of degree 2. This is called a quadratic equation. There's one formula that will solve all degree 2 equations. It's the familiar quadratic formula everyone learns in high school. This one formula involving addition and subtraction and radicals that will solve all degree 2 polynomial equations. Although it wasn't written exactly this form until the 1600s, mathematicians have known this formula essentially also all the way back to the beginning of algebra around the year 800. At the beginning of algebra as a subject, around 800 AD, mathematicians had formulas for solving any degree 1 and degree 2 equations, but no one knew a formula to solve any degree 3 equation. It took about 700 years to figure it out. In the 1500s, mathematicians by the names of Delfero, Cardano, and Tartaglia found one single formula that could solve all degree 3 equations. That formula is now called Cardano's formula, and it looks like this. It is one formula that provides a solution to any cubic degree 3 equation. One formula to rule them all. Also in the 1500s, Cardano's student, a mathematician named Ferrari, found one formula to solve any quartic or degree 4 equation. After some algebraic substitutions and manipulation, a solution can be found with the following formula. You can see more about this, for example, on Wikipedia. Again, it's one formula that provides a solution to any quartic or degree 4 equation. There's actually now, in the modern form, 4 different versions because there are actually 4 different solutions for a degree 4, just like there are 3 different solutions for a degree 3 equation, and there are 2 solutions for a degree 2. Mathematicians at the time of the 1500s didn't know there were 4 different solutions. Galois knew that, but essentially, the point is that there was one formula to solve, to find a solution to any equation of degree 4 all the way back in the 1500s. So the quadratic formula was known to the ancients. Mathematicians in the 15th century found general formulas to solve degree 3 and degree 4 polynomial equations using operations of arithmetic and square roots and cube roots. But it was not until the 1800s, 300 years later, that Galois developed a proof that no such method or general formula could ever be devised that would solve every degree 5 polynomial equation. In fact, Galois' proof also showed that no such general method or formula could ever be developed to solve polynomial equations with degree 5 or greater. This was an amazing achievement, first because Galois solved a centuries-old question when he was just 20, but also amazing in that his proof opened the door to modern algebra. So what is group theory? Since Galois' discovery, group theory has grown into a major branch of modern algebra. As the mathematical language of symmetry, it has many applications in all branches of mathematics, but in particular in computer science and physics and chemistry, basically all of modern science. In Galois' mathematics, a group is a set of elements and a rule to combine those elements which satisfy certain properties. Sometimes the elements of the group are numbers, but there are many other examples. The elements of a group could be the symmetries of a molecule, the rotations of an object, or the elements themselves could be the different ways of rearranging another set of elements. As the mathematics of symmetry, group theory is important in art too. It's an important result in group theory that proved there are only 17 possible wallpaper patterns. That is, every possible wallpaper pattern that could ever be created must be one of these 17 basic patterns that are shown here. To really understand group theory, we can begin with some definitions. First, a binary operation is a rule combining elements of a set that will always produce another element of the same type. For example, addition is a binary operation. If you combine two numbers with addition, you get a result, which is another number. Compositions of functions is a binary operation. Composing two functions, which means putting one function inside another, that produces another function. And combining moves of the Rubik's Cube is a binary operation. Combining one move with another move is itself another move. This operation of combining moves could be described as the operation followed by, as in one move followed by another move results in a combined move. So now a group is a set G of elements with a binary operation star that satisfies the following three properties. 1. There's an identity element E such that for all elements A in the set G, combining the identity element with any element A in any particular order always gives you the original element A. For every element A in G, there's an inverse element, A to the minus 1 here, such that combining any element with its inverse in any order produces the identity element. And the operation star is associative. That is, for elements A, B, and C in the set G, combining the elements in this way with these grouping symbols produces an equality. So first example, the group of integers with addition. The set of integers with the operation of addition is an example of a group. The first property, there's an identity element, namely 0. We see for any integer, if you add any integer x plus 0, whether you add 0 at the end or in the beginning, you get the original element x. For every element in the group, there's an inverse. Specifically, the inverse of x is minus x. In general, combining any element with its inverse produces the identity. For example, 6 plus negative 6 is 0. So 0 is the identity, and for every number there's an inverse. Like here, you can see that every element, 6, has an inverse, minus 6, that when you put them together, you get 0, the identity. And the addition of integers is associative. In general, for any integers A, B, and C, we have this equality that A plus B followed by adding C is the same as A added to the quantity B plus C. Example 2, the group of rationals without 0 and the operation of multiplication. The set of rationals without 0 together with the operation of multiplication is an example of a group. There's an identity element. Here it's 1. We see for any rational number x, any number times 1 is going to give you x, like 5 times 1, it's 5. For every element in the group, there's an inverse. Specifically, the inverse of x is 1 over x. So in general, combining any element with its inverse produces the identity. So for example, take the number 6 and its inverse, multiplicative inverse is 1 over 6. Multiplying those two together, combining those two together with the operation, gives you 1, which is the identity. And finally, multiplication of rational numbers is associative. In general, for any numbers A, B, and C, we have always true that A times B times C is the same as A times the quantity B times C. Just a note that 0 is not included in this group because it would have no inverse by multiplication. That is, there's no number times 0 that would produce that identity 1. Third example, a dihedral group. That's the set of all possible rotations and reflections of the octagon. You could call this the stop sign group. Here the composition or the operation is followed by. The operation is the composition, which we can call followed by, but mathematically you use the word composition. This is an example of a group. The picture below shows the result of each element of the group. The elements are the actual motions, the rotations or the reflections that are possible, and the operation in this group is the combination of any two possible motions. This is called the dihedral group of the octagon, and it has 16 elements. The 16 different images you see there are 8 different rotations of 45 degrees and 8 different reflections of the original stop sign. The elements of the dihedral group of the octagon, this stop sign group, are the 8 possible rotations and 8 possible reflections whose effects on the original sign are shown. So the word stop is there only so you can sort of see how it's actually been reflected and rotated, but because in each case you're getting the original octagon, these are all of the symmetries of the octagon. So the operation in this group is the combination of rotations or reflections. Any combination will result in one of these 16 results shown above. We can refer to the operation in this group as followed by, for example, one rotation followed by another rotation is itself another rotation. To verify this is really a group, we can check each of the three conditions. One, there is an identity element. In this case, the identity is do nothing. Notice that do nothing followed by some move x is equal to that move x. And this is analogous to an algebraic equation that says 1 times x is equal to x. So the identity in multiplication is 1. It would be the same as 0 plus x is 0. So the identity in addition is 0. So the identity in the dihedral group is doing nothing. And also in this group, in the dihedral group, for every element, there's an inverse. The inverse of any move is simply the move that undoes it. That is the reverse rotation or the reverse reflection. So the inverse of x is the move that, combined with x, produces the identity, that is, as if nothing had been done. And this operation of followed by is associative. That's the third property. Consider any three moves, A and B and C. Move A, followed by the combination of B followed by C, is the same as the combination of move A followed by B, followed by the operation, followed by the element C. Essentially, with the operation followed by, these parentheses really have no effect, meaning that the operation is associative. So consider subtraction with the integers. Would this be a group? There is an identity, namely 0. You could subtract 0 and you haven't changed the value. And every number does have an inverse, specifically for any given integer x, there is always an integer a such that x take away a is 0. In fact, every number would equal its own inverse in this particular example, because you could say if you took the element 6, you could just subtract 6 and then you would get 0. But this operation is not associative, and that's where it fails to be a group. Right? Consider 5 minus 3 followed by minus 2, or compare that to 5 subtract 3 minus 2, the quantity 3 minus 2. This is not equal because you got 0 on the left, 5 minus 3 is 2, take away 2, that's 0, and on the right you've got 5 take away 1, which is 4. So this particular operation is not associative. This means subtraction with the integers is not a group. So example 4, now the Rubik's Cube group. All possible rearrangements of a Rubik's Cube is an example of a group. There's a one-to-one correspondence between the distinct permutations of the cube and the elements of the Rubik's Cube group. In each different permutation, that represents the result of a single element of the Rubik's Cube group, just as the different images of the stop sign had represented the result of each element in that group. Now, to be precise, the different moves of the cube could correspond to the same final permutation and therefore would correspond to the same single element of the Rubik's Cube group. In other words, a single element of the Rubik's Cube group could be expressed in different ways, using different sequences of moves, just as a rotation of 405 degrees is the same as a rotation of 45 degrees, or the rational number 2 over 4 is the same as the number 1/2. We can use the expression followed by again to represent the operation in this group. In other words, one move followed by another move is itself a move of the Rubik's Cube. So the number of elements in the Rubik's Cube group is 43 quintillion 252 quadrillion 3,274,489,856,000, because there are that many possible distinct permutations of the cube that can be reached by legal moves. What I mean is, a legal move is any combination of turns of any of the faces of the cube. An illegal move would be result from breaking apart the cube or peeling off the stickers, and those don't count. So any two legal moves can be combined, and the result would be one of those distinct permutations. We can check that the properties of a group are satisfied to verify that the Rubik's Cube group satisfies the three properties of a group, consider there is an identity element, namely not doing any move. Notice, for example, not doing any move followed by some move equals the move. And for each element, there's an inverse. The inverse of move x on the Rubik's Cube is the move that undoes move x. Notice, for example, how any move followed by its inverse will produce the identity element, meaning the result is not doing any move. And the operation followed by, that is, composition, is associative. Given three moves, performing the first followed by the composition of the second two is equivalent to the composition of the first two followed by the third, provided that the order remains the same. Now suppose G is a group with some arbitrary binary operation star. We say the operation star is commutative if for all x and y in the set G, it's true that x combined with y equals y combined with x when you change the order. When you change the order with the operation, if you have equality, you have a commutative group. And when the operation is commutative, we say that group is abelian. For example, addition is commutative because x plus y is y plus x always. 3 plus 5, for example, is 5 plus 3. Therefore, the group of integers with addition is an abelian group. Multiplication is commutative because x times y is equal to y times x, like 3 times 5 is the same as 5 times 3. Therefore, the group of rationals without zero is an abelian group. But not all binary operations are commutative. Subtraction is not commutative. For example, 3 minus 5 is not equal to 5 minus 3. And division is not commutative. For example, 10 divided by 2 is not equal to 2 divided by 10. The binary operation followed by that's used in the dihedral group and the Rubik's Cube group, they're not commutative. Consider combining two elements from the dihedral group. A 45-degree counterclockwise rotation followed by a vertical reflection. That produces this three images that you see at the top row. A vertical reflection, though, followed by a 45-degree counterclockwise rotation is shown underneath that. And combining these elements in different orders produces different results. You see that that last stop sign looks different. So this illustrates the fact that the dihedral group of the octagon is not a commutative group. It's not an abelian group. And the Rubik's Cube group is not a commutative group. Consider two example elements from the group. So R means a clockwise turn of the right side. You can imagine holding it in front of you and turning the right side one turn clockwise. And D, that's a clockwise turn of the downside. So if you did a clockwise turn, you can see it on the right image there of the Rubik's Cube. Applying move R, turning the right side one turn forward, and then turning the bottom clockwise 145-degree turn. If you did that, you'd have the image on the left, and if you did the D first, you turn the downside clockwise once, and then you turn the right side once, the result's different, as you can see in the image, and the fact that the operation followed by in the Rubik's Cube group is not commutative is what makes the puzzle so difficult. Aside from the large number of permutations. So imagine if it were commutative. This would mean that to solve the puzzle, it wouldn't matter what order the moves were applied. Simply rotating each face an appropriate number of times eventually would suffice in solving the puzzle. So the power of algebra is in knowing properties that hold true for all numbers. And group theory is a generalization of that. Group theory provides deductive conclusions that would be true in all groups. We know that the Rubik's Cube is an example of a group, therefore anything that's true for a group in general would be true for the Rubik's Cube. For example, let's look at subgroups. A subgroup of a group G is a subset A of G that is itself a group with the operation that was used in G. If a group is finite, repeatedly applying the group operation to a single element in the group will generate a subgroup that must eventually repeat. For example, in the dihedral group, rotating the stop sign by 45 degrees counterclockwise and following that with continued subsequent rotations will generate each element of an 8-element subgroup. You'd go through all the turns of the 8 sides of the stop sign and you'd get back to the original stop sign. In the Rubik's Cube group, it's a big group, 43 quintillion elements, but it's still a finite group, and that means any subgroup generated by repeated moves will eventually repeat. The number of elements in a group or a subgroup, that's called the order of that group. And an important theorem of group theory says that the order of every subgroup must divide the order of the group. The most simple example of a subgroup on the Rubik's Cube is the repeated rotation of one side. Those would be subgroups of order 4 because rotating one side of the cube generates a subgroup of order 4 because the permutations of the cubies, those are the little cubes, they repeat again after 4 rotations. In other words, you get back to where you started when you rotate 4 times. Now consider the sequence of moves RLUD. That means turn the right side clockwise, then the left side clockwise, then the up top side clockwise, and then the down side clockwise. It means hold the cube in a fixed position and looking at it, turn each of these sides clockwise one at a time, right, left, up, down. This sequence is a combination of moves, and therefore together forms a single element of the Rubik's Cube group. Combine the element RLUD with itself 6 times using the group operation followed by, in other words, RLUD followed by RLUD. Do that 6 times. Repeat the sequence RLUD followed by itself a total of 6 times, and you discover the subgroup generated by this RLUD has order 6 because the resulting permutations begin repeating again after the sequence is repeated. So if you did that sequence with a solved cube, and you did it 6 times, you'd get back to the solved cube again. It's a pretty neat trick. Try repeating that pattern 6 times, and the cube will scramble itself, and it magically returns to the original state after 6 repetitions of this move, RULD. But be careful, don't mess up. You have to do in order RLUD exactly 6 times to get back to the original cube, because the subgroup generated by the element RULD, that's just a slight change in the sequence where I just invert U then L, well, that element creates a subgroup of order 315. So if you did RULD, you'd have to repeat 315 times before you ever got back to your original starting point. We can factor the order of the Rubik's Cube group as follows. That 43 quintillion number can factor. This is another part of group theory that's used in cryptology, in basically creating encryption methods for sending information on the internet, is the ability to factor very large numbers. So in this particular factorization, you notice there's no factor of 13, and therefore there are no subgroups of order 13 in the Rubik's Cube. In other words, no sequence of moves that will repeat after 13 moves. That's just a fact that I could say mathematically has to be true about the Rubik's Cube. No sequence that repeats after 13 moves. In mathematically impossible, and it'll never happen on any Rubik's Cube. Recall that solving equations in beginning algebra requires using inverses. For example, we solve the equation 3x plus 10 equal 22 as follows. Subtract 10 from both sides, divide both sides by 3, you got x equal 4, right? But what you're doing is you're applying an additive inverse of 10 to both sides to isolate that 3x term. And then you're applying a multiplicative inverse of 3 to both sides to isolate the factor of x. So just like solving a Rubik's Cube, solving a linear equation means unscrambling the given equation using combinations of inverse operations to reach that solved state. Like solving an equation, solving the Rubik's Cube requires combining the elements of a group with their inverses. Solving equations like 3x plus 10 equals 22 requires the right algebra moves, just like solving a Rubik's Cube. The first move is to apply the additive inverse of 10, the next is to apply the multiplicative inverse of 3, like turning one face of the Rubik's Cube, and then the other, in a certain order. Solving an equation like 3x squared minus 9x plus 5 equals 2 requires three different kinds of inverses: additive inverses, multiplicative inverse, and also square roots. That's the inverse of squaring. So the quadratic formula, x equals minus b plus or minus the square root b squared minus 4ac all divided by 2a, is just like a sequence of moves that a person memorizes to solve a Rubik's Cube. That is, it's a sequence of moves that allow you to that you can follow to unscramble a puzzle that looks like this. In algebra, we learn first you have to get your puzzle in this form, and if you can do that, there's a sequence of moves, that quadratic formula, that gets you to the solved state. What Galois did is amazing, and bear in mind, all by the time he was 20 years old. First, he understood the formulas to solve any degree 1, 2, 3, or even 4, degree 4 polynomial equation. Sort of like someone who knows how to solve many different size Rubik's Cubes. And he was looking for a formula that would solve any degree 5 polynomial. It was like he was looking for a way to solve a very difficult higher dimensional Rubik's Cube. He wanted a sequence of moves that would take any degree 5 polynomial and reduce it to a solved state. What he actually discovered and was able to prove was that degree 5 polynomials are somehow different. They are impossible to solve the way we solve degree 1 through 4. There's no sequence of inverses, and there never will be a sequence that reduces any degree 5 polynomial to the solved state. And further, he showed that this is true for degree 6 polynomials and any higher degree polynomial. It's like degree 5 and higher polynomials are built differently, and there's no way to create a sequence of inverse moves that will solve them. So a lot of people enjoy solving the Rubik's Cube, and yet still may not fully realize its many deep connections to mathematics. Like a math problem itself, solving the cube is challenging and rewarding and can build one's confidence in solving other puzzles. Also, understanding the Rubik's Cube opens a door to understanding advanced mathematics. The mathematics discovered about 200 years ago by a brilliant French teenager named Evariste Galois. So that's the end of the video. Thank you very much for watching. There's a good book for further reading if you're interested in this material. It's called The Equation That Couldn't Be Solved: How Mathematical Genius Discovered the Language of Symmetry by Mario Livio.